Hi, everybody. Welcome. Come on in. Get settled. Get your sandwiches opened up. Get the chip wrappers opened up. We have a very exciting hour and a half in store for you. We are joined today, as you know, by General Petraeus, David Petraeus. Today, the General is a partner with the global investment firm KKR and chairman of KKR's Global Institute. But as you all know, the General has had a long and extremely distinguished military career and career in service to this country, serving for over 37 years in the U.S. military, including command of the coalition forces during the surge in Iraq, command of U.S. Central Command, CENTCOM, and command of coalition forces during the surge in Afghanistan. Following his service in the military, General Petraeus, as I'm sure you also know, served as director of the Central Intelligence Agency. Here at this Institute of Higher Learning, I thought I would just acknowledge for a moment his academic credentials, or in this world, your street cred, if you will. General Petraeus graduated with distinction from the U.S. Military Academy in 1974 and then was the top graduate in the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College class of 1983, and then subsequently earned a PhD from Princeton University's Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs. So I wasn't kidding when I said he had street cred in the academic world. But most significantly for us and for this community, General Petraeus is the Judge Whitney Professor here at USC. And thanks to that very special relationship, we are fortunate to welcome the General here today. I'm going to kick off the conversation with some questions, and we're joined by Vice Dean Professor Phil Seib, who will also be taking part in the conversation, but then we're going to make sure that we save plenty of time afterwards for questions from the audience or questions from all of you. So after that lengthy introduction, General, welcome. Thanks for joining us today.
Thanks. It's great to be with two legends in the field of journalism, and wonderful to be in this place that has so much energy and vibe to it.
As I said, the upside of this great place is the energy, and the downside is the energy. So come on in, everybody. You're welcome. I see people passing by looking, oh, goodness, the General's here. I thought I'd start with some questions that are very much in the news today. Starting with Syria. As you well know, President Obama announced a change in U.S. Syria strategy that he will be sending special ops forces in an advisory capacity. The president has been very clear these aren't boots on the ground, but do you think that the U.S. will have to commit ground troops to fighting ISIS?
I don't think ground combat forces, and I've not been one who has advised that, but the fact is that Syria has evolved over the several years of its civil war into far more than just, and it was already a vicious, violent battle between the regime forces, the Alawite Shia forces of Bashar al-Assad, and the majority of the country, the Sunni Arab opposition, which he put down very violently and which then really rose up in response to that. Syria has now evolved into a regional sectarian civil war being fought by proxies, and now it even has global dimensions with the addition, of course, of Russian forces that are actively supporting Bashar al-Assad's regime forces. Bashar also supported by the Iranian Revolutionary Guards Corps Quds Force advisors, by Lebanese Hezbollah funded by Iran, and by some Shia militia from the region as well. And then on the other side, you have a coalition of well over 60 countries led by the United States supporting a kaleidoscope, really, of different Sunni opposition forces, and you have the resurrection of the Islamic State, which drifted over from Iraq, having been destroyed in its form of al-Qaeda in Iraq during the surge, but then was allowed to get back up off the mat, if you will, and given new life by the sectarian policies that were followed by the Prime Minister of Iraq, sadly, after our departure. So Syria now is a geopolitical Chernobyl. It is spewing. It's a volcano that is spewing violence, instability, extremism, and refugees, not just in Syria, not just in the region, but now obviously extending into Europe, and with ISIS having, at the very least, inspired attacks in Europe and in the United States and even out in the Asia-Pacific region. The 50 advisors certainly won't be enough to stem this, but they actually will have a lot more effect, I think, than people realize.
In what sense? How?
Well, they will be most likely over in the northeastern part of the country. That's quite a ways from where the Russian forces are, which is significant. And they will be able to provide a level of coordination, a level of assistance, links to intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance assets that have truly transformed the way we are fighting in Iraq and in Syria. You know, we didn't have remotely the number of platforms overhead back in, even in the day of the surge in Iraq. These have proliferated. Frankly, this is a result of requests, very, very strong requests from me and the battlefield commanders in Iraq and Afghanistan. And again, the proliferation of Predators, Reapers, and a variety of other platforms, not to mention the manned aircraft and so on, this has enabled us to fight in a way that we never could have in the past. And the fact is that in Iraq, as an example, you need all the elements of the surge that we, the surge strategy, the civil military counterinsurgency campaign plan, but with huge differences in the sense that it has to be Iraqi forces on the ground, and it also has to be the Iraqis who do the reconciliation, who bring the Sunni Arabs back into the fabric of Iraqi society, as we did during the surge, something that was tragically undone several years after the surge by sectarian policies followed by Iraqi leadership. I have publicly, I testified before the Senate Armed Services Committee for 3 hours a few weeks ago. I have advocated the establishment of whatever you want to call them, safe havens, sanctuaries that we would protect, and that we would tell Bashar al-Assad, if you drop barrel bombs on it, your air assets are going to go away.
And we would protect how?
Well, there are a variety of ways that you could do it. I think a no-fly zone in the north and the south would probably be the best. You could, in action short of that, literally just crater the runways that the aircraft, the fixed-wing aircraft, use, and then provide some form of air defenses. And depending on where the zone is located, they wouldn't even have to necessarily be inside Syria or well inside Syria. That gets into some tactical issues. But again, if we don't protect those we are trying to help by arming, training, funding, and so forth against all enemies, not just the Islamic State, which we want them to fight, but we do have to protect them from Bashar al-Assad's forces as well. Now, I am not one who advocates pushing Bashar out until we have some sense of what is going to follow him. Syria, tragically, as horrific as it is, with 300,000 Syrians having been killed now, and with half the population of Syria, pre-war population, having been displaced internally or externally. I mean, this is just a colossal humanitarian disaster in addition to everything else. But again, it actually could get worse if the central authority over the areas that the regime still controls were to disappear, or there were to be infighting there. So again, it's accurate to say that there is no military solution to the problems of Syria, or Iraq for that matter. There is, however, a military context that is very much necessary in Syria if people are really going to go to the diplomacy tables and have meaningful discussions.
What is the path to the diplomacy tables?
Well, there's going to have to be sufficient pressure on Bashar al-Assad and his regime forces, and now on their backers, so that they realize that we're going to have to negotiate something, or they could literally lose the remaining areas that they control, and that could mean, for example, Russia losing its bases. The reason Russia came in is to protect its naval base at Tartus on the Mediterranean. This is the so-called Syrian Riviera, it used to be anyway. And then there's an air base further to the north of that, at Latakia. It very much wants to retain those bases, wants to retain its power, if you will. Vladimir Putin does appear to like to stride the global stage. If he can poke us in the eye at the same time, even better. So those are the objectives we think there.
And how much of a concern is it that this becomes more than a poke in the eye from Putin having Russian forces?
That's
a big concern. And the danger that it
sure
increases for our troops.
Yep. No, that's a big concern. We need to be sensitive to an escalation that would actually involve our two forces. As an example, if they keep going after our guys, if you will, which Russia has largely been doing. Russia has said, Vladimir Putin said he came into Syria, deployed forces to Syria to battle the Islamic State, Well, about 80 to 90% of his sorties have actually been bombing the very forces that we have been supporting and that have actually achieved reasonable success on the battlefield against Bashar al-Assad. That's in the north. There's also forces in the south that have done reasonably well.
Another question about U.S. armed forces around the globe, Afghanistan, of course, the president also announcing that he will keep troops there. How likely is it 5-10 years from now we still have 10,000 troops there?
I don't know what the number will be, but I'm actually quite confident that we will still be providing a measure of support for Afghanistan and undoubtedly for Afghan security forces. It's just not realistic to expect that Afghanistan, given where it was and with the lack of infrastructure, even the lack of literacy. I mean, the challenges in Afghanistan are colossal, not to mention the fact that the major insurgent movements that are making life so difficult for Afghanistan actually have their senior leaders outside the country. The Afghan Taliban is down in Balochistan. The Al-Qaeda senior leaders and the Haqqani movement are in the federally administered tribal areas. Al-Qaeda has sustained enormous losses, of course, from various things that have been happening to them. And then a handful of others, and they're all, their leaders tend to be outside the country. That's very, very difficult. It's very frustrating, candidly, if you're a commander and the neighboring country either can't or won't take that land back from them. And it's very, very difficult terrain, to be fair to our Pakistani partners.
Before I turn over the mic to Phil for a little bit, I want to ask you how you think the U.S. media, legacy media, new media alike, does on covering these issues. They're complicated.
Yep.
They're far away. They seem remote from day-to-day life of Americans. None of those are excuses, but they're reasons. How do you think we do?
I think that the mainstream media does a reasonably good job in discharging its responsibilities, if you will, to its customers. And let me explain what I felt. I actually have this whole wonderful briefing that's slightly whimsical, but it's about dealing with the press. And I used to give it with a guy named Rick Atkinson, who's a multi-time Pulitzer Prize winner, who happened to ride with me in my Humvee during the fight to Baghdad. And unfortunately, a couple of different times, I forgot he was in the vehicle and said something, not realizing that it was not all off the record. But among those was, where I asked him, tell me how this ends. And that became, quite a quoted comment, even the title of a book. But my view is that there are three major responsibilities that the press has, at least I felt. The first, obviously, is to try to get the facts right, to really, truly report objectively what it is that took place. The second is to provide a degree of context. Now, let me explain this a little bit, because it makes a world of difference if the context in which a U.S. soldier just shot a vehicle full of civilians, and if it was in broad daylight down in the southern part of Iraq where there hasn't been a suicide car bomb in the last 2 years, and there was no intelligence suggesting that that was coming their way, or it's in the middle of the night in Baghdad in a rainstorm, and there have been 3 car bombings that night already, and warning of another one coming, and the vehicle ignores the chicane or the stop signs and the various barriers and just barrels on through. I mean, that context is very, very different, and it really matters. And I have had examples in this briefing where the context was improper. They just got it wrong or conveyed the wrong message. The third is to get the characterization right. And by characterization, I mean that you've got the facts right, okay, got the context right. So what are the implications? What does it mean? What are the conclusions? And this is one I think that is difficult. I remember particularly, in fact, I went to Donald Graham, the at that time still the owner of the Washington Post, personally, and conveyed, a degree of disappointment. He was a former military journalist, by the way, in Vietnam, and a very good man, and ran a great newspaper. But they had a title of a story that said, it was titled Mission Improbable, Training Iraq Security Forces. But the story only conveyed details about one of, admittedly somewhat dysfunctional U.S. unit and one certainly dysfunctional Iraqi unit and their relationship and how rocky the whole situation was. Clearly not a great picture, but it didn't really necessarily give you the right to extrapolate that the whole mission is improbable, given that there were probably 1,000 other companies out there in similar relationships. And he actually agreed with that. And as you know, what happens is the journalist comes back and says, well, you know, I don't write the headlines, I just write the story. And but someone writes the headlines, and they've got to get that piece of it right as well.
And they do report to Donald Graham, typically.
They did indeed. So now, beyond the mainstream media, the problem now is that, you know, what is the media? Who is the media? I mean, every person in here with a cell phone is a media, could be. And you have now, obviously, not just 24-hour news coverage and on news on traditional television. You've got all kinds of outlets that are via the internet. There's social media that's playing a much, much more significant role. And, you know, everything has to be reduced to the number of characters in a Twitter message. I forget what the new, the, I mean, there's one that's now taking over that, which is a picture with a few. Our daughter keeps us posted on all this. But so what is the media? And I think that's the challenge. And then, frankly, the intensity, I think, of scrutiny, because all of these different potential media people, journalists, are in a sense competing with one another to get a story that will rise to the top of the heap. And so you find, I think, the traditional media is under pressure big time. It's got to get out there. It's got to be edgy. It's got to have a story that will attract viewers, readers. But they're being intruded on. I mean, their space is really being squeezed by all of the newly emerging media elements. So how are you dealing with that? Are you dealing with
the pressure? I like the way you're describing this as a military battle. Even the hand gestures were very similar to your description of Syria. And it's and not inaccurate. How are we dealing with it? We're teaching and training and equipping students to be really prepared for today's current technology and emerging technologies, to be mindful of the audiences that they're speaking to be relentlessly focused on fundamentals, accuracy, timeliness, context.
Yep. By the way, what I wanted us to do as the commander of the surge in Iraq or Afghanistan or Central Command or wherever, our goal when it came to dealing with the press was to be first with the truth. And what we wanted to do, you know, we literally wanted to try to beat the bad guys to the headline is what we called it. And this is tough because if, you know, you go into Sadr City, the Shia neighborhood of 2 million people, we're very densely populated, and we would, that's the only decision that I retained for myself every single day. Everything else was delegated. We had conditions, they met the conditions, they could do what it was that they needed to do. But whether or not we were going to, into Sadr City each night with our Joint Special Operations Command forces, our special mission units, that was something I'd make the call somewhere around 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Occasionally, I would literally, I'd call the ambassador, my very, very close comrade, Ryan Crocker, or occasionally even the prime minister. And I'd say, Prime Minister, what do you think? You know, we think there's a target there, very important leader of a very violent Shia militia. We think we can get him, but you know, every time we go in, it's hard getting out. And again, it's one of those places that's much easier to get in than it is to exfiltrate. And you'll have a firefight on your hands. And can we bear this? Can the political situation right now, you know, will this crack it? And they had, the Shia militia, literally had the CNN Baghdad bureau chief's cell phone number speed dialed into their cell phone. And they're on a cell phone immediately, often with video, that they would try to explain was, you know, us doing something egregious. We, by the way, had stuff overhead with full motion video where we would try to get pump that to, again, the press. So this is a huge deal because if you lose the headline, you then become the subtitle. And, you know, so it's U.S. kills 20 civilians in Sadr City. Well, we get the subtitle that says U.S. claims not the case. So there is huge pressure, but you've got to have the facts right. And, you know, the challenge, in fact, you know the old adage that in the military, you know, the first report is always wrong. So you're really racing to try to get the facts, to be first with the truth. And as I said, again, it's the truth. It's not, you can't put lipstick on a pig. If it's pig, go out and say, you know, we had a horrible day, we made a mistake, I screwed something up. Don't go out and try to sugarcoat it or spin it. In fact, we had some very, very good people engaged in this. It was called Strategic Communications. And I actually allowed the first individual in it when I arrived for the surge, a two-star general I knew very, very well, a personal friend. Allowed him to move on to his next assignment a little bit earlier because he just found it very difficult to step up to the mic every afternoon. We would have a briefing and just acknowledge when we had a horrible day. But I mean, we had a terrible bombing, two bombings of two marketplaces. These are massive marketplaces. I think over 150 Iraqis killed just in those two incidents, and there were others in the early days of the surge. And he led with the fact that we'd reopened three schools and had a health clinic operating again, and then got to this stuff. And I said, you should have gone out. You should have said, ladies and gentlemen, we had a bad day in Baghdad today, a very bad day. 150 Iraqi citizens are killed, murdered by, you know, this. And then go on to say, we are looking hard at this. Here's what we think we're taking from this. We're going to initiate a number of steps, including barricading off every single market, which we had to do. These are mile-long stretches of road with shops on either side, and then they go several streets back. You've seen these. And we had to put what were called Texas barriers, huge concrete walls linked all the way around them, and they were no drive zones because you couldn't allow vehicles in there. It was just too difficult to keep the car bombs out.
So how effective do you think you were ultimately at changing the culture, changing the nature of your relationship with the press and how you communicated, and has that been a lasting change?
You know, the perspective on how I dealt with the press depends on where you were. I think it's fair to say that the press said that I was among the most accessible figures in uniform. I knew that I had become the face of the surge. I didn't seek that. I just knew it. I knew that there was no one above me had either the visibility or the credibility at that point. Remember, it's 2007. It's a, the Republican Party has just lost control of both houses because of Iraq. President confounds them all by going all in, not just double down with the surge. And by God, then it does ultimately succeed. We worked very hard to be accessible. That is a responsibility I felt we had. My view, in fact, in that wonderful little PowerPoint I have, you know, it used to say, it's not my army, it's America's army, and America has a right to know what it's doing and to know the thoughts of the individuals who are leading it. So we did a ton of press, and you know, I think some of the activities that we had, the testimony on Capitol Hill in September 11th, 2007, for example, among the most sort of covered events, you know, they'd run out of room in the well for photographers, for goodness sake. Having said that, there is a longstanding tradition, which I was happy to practice prior to that, for the most part, which was when dealing with the press, never pass up the opportunity to keep your mouth shut. And, you know, I said, that's not an option for us, regrettably, because, you know, another one was, I have a whole series of, you know, you can't win if you don't play, and there was a bunch of nice stories that were, you know, about me over the years at that time. Then there was, you can't lose if you don't play, and there's a bunch of horrible stories about things, in some cases accurate depictions, in some cases not. And then it was, but you got to play, again, it's not my army, it's their army, and they have a right to know who's leading their sons and daughters and how we think we're doing. Having said that, I know that there were people that were uncomfortable above me, particularly as faces and administrations changed in Washington. We made some mistakes, actually, the three of us, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, General McChrystal and myself, some of these were misperceptions, I really do think, but then there were some no-kidding mistakes as well, and that didn't help.
Can you give us an example of a no-kidding mistake?
Well, we, both the chairman and I, had done interviews prior to the announcement, I think it was, that there was going to be another assessment of the way forward in Afghanistan. And we were frankly acting in accordance with guidance that had just come out from the National Security Council staff, which had taken a long time since the previous one that was announced. And the words in it literally were that we were going to do a fully resourced, comprehensive civil military counterinsurgency campaign. And so we basically sent that back. Mine was misfortunate in that I did it. I didn't realize that the individual who was, and this is a lick on me, was a speechwriter for the Bush, I don't know, Bush one or something like that, first administration, Michael Gerson, very competent guy, but can be, and at sometimes has been, he can go after folks. And so there was a sense that the chairman and I were trying to box the president in before we started this review, which we, again, we were still operating under the old, weren't aware that we were going to get into the new. We all decided to lie low, and, you know, uncharacteristically for me. But, I mean, I remember I did an event. It was so heavily covered. It was just a simple sort of U.S. Marine Corps Association event. And there's 30 cameras there because they're all waiting for me to say something that would be at odds with the administration, the president. And I actually got a review the next day. It was written by Tom Ricks, Washington Post, and it was titled, it was on a blog, it was titled, Dave Does Dull. And, you know, I'd been so careful, and I had been, I wrote to him and I said, Tom, you have no idea how much skill was required to be dull on the topic we were discussing, which presumably was Afghanistan right in the middle of the policy review. Unfortunately, General McChrystal later was in London doing an event with one of the big think tanks. Superb speech, but in a Q&A said some things that were getting out ahead of the administration. And that was that, and that seemed as if there they go again. I don't know if you remember, but there was the picture of him on Air Force One. The president stops to meet with him, and he's sort of leaning forward like this, the two of them looking at each other. And that was, you know, let's come to grips with this. So those were issues, and they were real issues. And, you know, the fact that somebody is high profile is not as applauded at some times as it might be in others. And what's okay in one period may not be again, okay in another, and you just have to feel your way along in that. But, you know, it can have ramifications.
Phil?
I'd like to stay with news media issues, and in this instance, talk a little bit about the news media of one of our sort of adversaries, the Russians.
Yeah.
Both their domestic and international news organizations, such as RT and Sputnik, are very important for their, for the Kremlin's new adventurism. Are there ways that the United States and NATO can push back?
There are. Look, it's difficult, though, in dealing with organizations that aren't encumbered with a need to tell the truth. So this isn't just spin or perspective. I mean, we all know that there are certain media that align with, you know, a certain part of the political spectrum and others that are on the other part, and then some that are in the middle, and we know where the editorial policies are of, say, the Washington Post or the New York Times or LA Times, what have you. But these guys just really, again, completely spin and beyond. And so you're a little bit hamstrung by that, except that over time they're going to be discredited. But you've still got to get your message in. We have various organs, Voice of America, BBC World, believe it or not. I remember here I was in the Kuwait desert. We're on the eve of what we think is going to be the invasion of Iraq. It does turn out to be. I was a two-star division commander of the 101st Airborne Division. And I was actually getting my own information the same way that people in that part of the world do. And it was a radio. And we'd tune into BBC World every night to find out what was going on around us. We didn't have the kinds of global internet connectivity that we have now. So, But again, here you've got to also keep up with the fact of mobile devices and figure out how can you feed those? Are your apps adapted for that? Is it accessible and so forth? And then are you just keeping up with the volume and, again, the 24-hour responsibility that I think media organizations have? And VOA funding, obviously, has not been particularly high on the priority list. And nor has sustained funding for so-called public diplomacy from the State Department. I remember when I was the commander of U.S. Central Command after Iraq, before Afghanistan, the Undersecretary of State for, I think, public diplomacy is the title, I believe, a former very successful executive in the media world, flew all the way down to Tampa. And, you know, I said, what is this all about? I'd be happy to stop by when I'm up there or whatever. And anyway, she comes in and essentially was trying to get a few million dollars to help fund a program. Well, a few million dollars in the CENTCOM world was, you know, it wasn't pocket change, but it was available. But it was curious that, again, here's the State Department asking the Department of Defense for money. And it's just a commentary on the fact that we have never funded programs like public diplomacy and a host of others, frankly, at the State Department. One reason we had to have so many soldiers doing what otherwise would have been civilian tasks is just because we had the resources and the State Department did not. In fact, Secretary of State Clinton asked me personally on several occasions to testify on Capitol Hill, where I was sort of the poster boy for saying that, you know, they need some money, not just us. And there were times at which I almost would have been willing to shift some over, except that it's very, very difficult to do. So we have under-resourced a lot of these efforts. We did at Central Command have a program where we had individuals that had not just the language, native language, but the dialects that we needed. They had knowledge of the various subject matters, whether it was a variety of different social issues, religious issues, and so forth. So there were real scholars in these areas. And basically, they were injecting into social media a viewpoint that was certainly not on a variety of those social media. So in the extremist space and other spaces, and because you have to compete. This is a marketplace of ideas, and we have been losing in certain of those marketplaces. And we have to counter what the Islamic State has done very, very effectively, actually. And that's what makes them even more lethal in so many respects than Al-Qaeda, because they have such a facility and an ability in this space. And this is, again, this is not just lots of people on doing stuff. This is very technical. It's technological. It's using bots. It's amplifying it in various ways that you can. And we haven't gotten around to countering that adequately, certainly, at this point. And really, at the end of the day, what really has to happen is that it has to be a conversation in the Islamic world. And that's where, really, I think, and there's a number of countries, the United Arab Emirates, among others, that are recognizing this and realizing they've got to be the ones competing.
Well, this whole notion of the information battlefield is extremely important, and I think the U.S. military and other militaries are going to be getting into this a lot more in the future. And the big question, I think, is how do you make your voice heard in a din in which there are 500 million tweets every day?
Yep.
And so from a military standpoint or just from a more general foreign policymaker standpoint, what is the strategy that is evolving now? It doesn't seem to be that much except almost an ad hoc attempt to deal with the Islamic State. But then you have the Russians, for example, and the Baltics and so on.
Well, I can tell you that in Iraq during the surge, and we had, you know, just enormous resources, we actually hired a British, I guess it would be a media company, a no-kidding media company. And we put together with them, and then we have organic assets that used to be called psychological operations that sounds nefarious, like we're tinkering with people's brains, so we call them military information support teams. Changed the name, but, you know, protect the individuals. And anyway, all of them, and of course we had public affairs people, we had strategic communications people, we had the public diplomacy folks from state and the embassy. We pulled all of them together And we had a very substantial campaign of all different types of communication. What we did there is we identified the ways in which Iraqi citizens got their news and their information, and we had something for each of those. Now, again, we were absolutely forthright in the facts. We weren't spinning, but you know, it was important for an Iraqi to know that, by God, the amusement park in East Baghdad was reopened. This is not the kind of thing that they were seeing on the news. And in fact, there were channels that were showing nothing but extremist activities 24 hours a day until we objected to the countries in which those were based. But that we were able to do that and the program at CENTCOM candidly because we had such enormous resources and we had the number one priority in the world. And frankly, we were willing to all work together and acknowledge that if state doesn't have the money to do this in their public diplomacy program, then we're gonna help out in a very, very big way. And we did. I think there's a little bit less flexibility for that now. And certainly, I mean, just to begin with.
And where is that lack of flexibility coming from? Is that from the administration? Is that from the current command team?
Well, I mean, it starts probably with just the overall budget numbers, and sequestration has been a terrible blow. It's a meat axe to cutting. It's a terrible way to cut. So the budget deal that was done recently has a lot of positive features in that regard. It doesn't restore all that would have been lost, but it does quite a good job in that regard. So that's a start. And then just how many people are you willing to commit to this? Are you willing to, how do you balance the priorities in different regions? Are you willing to take some risk in the activities that you pursue? And, you know, I think it is not an overstatement that we've had a number of successes in the foreign policy field and the security field. I mean, Osama bin Laden is dead, the masterful individual in Yemen. I mean, there's a number of people that have been taken off the battlefield and will not threaten our citizens again as they did in the past. There have been achievements in a number of other areas as well. But Syria, I think we have been slow at various times, and I think the result is that the situation, there's no guarantees that if something was done early on that it would have been dramatically better, but it's hard to imagine that it could be anything worse.
A CIA-related question for you. Based on your tenure as CIA director, what's your feeling about U.S. news organizations, which of course are exponents of government transparency? Are they properly sensitive to the real-world necessities of secrecy in intelligence operations?
To a degree. And we dealt quite considerably with a number of media organizations and also individual authors. You know, people would give us a heads up and say, hey, this book is coming out. And, you know, I'd be willing to discuss if there's anything in there that someone's going to lose his life over or something like that. But frankly, there have been books that have exposed, you know, unbelievable programs. And, you know, we would actually sit down with individuals. They would sometimes remove certain items. We would have to then, though, be somewhat cooperative as well. I mean, there was a back and forth in this kind of relationship. But, no, there have been sources, methods. But the worst of all, of course, obviously, is Snowden. And Snowden is just an industrial strength release of many of the most sensitive programs out there. Thankfully, not all of them, not all the sources, et cetera. But that has been a real blow, and we know this. It's publicly known, it's been out there, that a number of the individuals we've tracked, extremist leaders, truly just changed the way they communicate. They changed the way they operate. They improved their operational security. And so that was a massive blow, and it is still, tragically, the gift that keeps on giving. By the way, we think that he was in virtually the last place within the NSA structure, or among the last at least, that did not have the kinds of alerts, we call them alarms, whistles, scrutiny, and so forth, that would have triggered a very quick focus on somebody downloading the number of programs that he downloaded. At the other agency, they never could have done that. It would have been impossible to do that without, again, alarms going off. And there's a lot of precautions that have been taken as a result of that.
Before we go to the audience for questions, I want to get your take on the Pentagon's move to ban the prohibition of women serving in combat roles. Given that we are a 74% female student body here, there is a great...
74%?
74%.
Are you kidding me?
Yep.
God, our son is still without a wife here. It'd be a great place for graduate school, wouldn't it?
Yeah, we'll send him my way.
He's a good, good lad. MIT graduate, Army captain with a future. Speaks Chinese.
It's getting better, getting better. By 2016, the ban on women in combat roles will be lifted unless the armed services present a justification for why this should not be the case. Do you expect any branch of the armed services will request an exemption?
I thought the Marine Corps had. I mean, is anybody, yes.
Yeah, they had officially?
I think the Marine Corps has. I think it has.
Yep. And are they likely to be granted an exception? And does Ash Carter make that decision ultimately?
Don't know. I'm sure he will, but this will be a decision that I assume he will. He'll make the decision, but he might consult some other people in government first. My view generally, first of all, let me just give you some context. When we did the fight to Baghdad, for example, 101st Airborne Division, we had women, and you know, there was the so-called combat prohibition or whatever, women weren't supposed to be in combat. Come on, I mean, we had women that were in engineer units that cleared improvised explosive devices. We had women in military police units that were doing convoy escort, running roads and doing a variety of different tasks like that. So again, you already had, even at that time, and this is before a number of the different skill areas were opened up further. And I remember one time, and we had a terrible firefight south of Baghdad and lost a battalion commander, the military police battalion commander. And I flew down there the next day. We were already up in the north and met with those who had been in this battle, did, you know, some good conversation and so forth, grip hands, and then pinned a Bronze Star medal for valor and a Purple Heart for being wounded on a woman whose face was still literally blue with shrapnel. I mean, you get all the metals in there and it eventually will grow out. She was in a very sustained firefight, manning a 50 caliber machine gun in a desperate fight trying to protect her battalion commander, who ultimately, as I said, got killed. It was a real tragedy. But she was not alone. There are many others. There now have been ones that have earned the medal above that, the Silver Star. Certainly a number have been killed in combat. And now we've seen, you know, my view generally was that you establish very clear standards. So if you want to be, I don't know, an infantryman, you look at the tasks that an infantryman has to do. They have to be rational. They can't be unrealistic. But, you know, you either can or cannot carry a, whatever it might be, 80-pound rucksack with a Kevlar and body armor and weapon and everything else. There are tests that will determine the ability to do that. Women have successfully completed Ranger school now. Actually, so I think we're up to three.
Still
and
waiting
the standards,
to become Rangers, however.
The standards were absolutely the same. Yep, no, that's a question, the Ranger regiment. And again, there have to be standards of conduct as well. I mean, we went through this with the LGBT gays in the military issue. And my view before that actually was that this is not going to be all that big a deal. And I think it has proven to be that way. By the way, I had a statement one time when I was the commander of Central Command. And, you know, we'd done the surge in Iraq, and obviously it had, you know, produced really extraordinary results. And I had a wonderful relationship with the chairman and the vice chairman of the Senate Armed Services Committee. Vice chairman was Senator McCain. Chairman was from Michigan. His name will come to me in a second. And they were on opposing sides of the whether to lift the ban or not. Senator McCain was in a very tough battle for the primary in Arizona and wanted to keep it in force, as I recall. Didn't want to let a review continue. And then the chairman wanted to actually declare it open. He was afraid that they'd lose control of the Senate in the upcoming November election, and I think they did. And he wanted to resolve it beforehand while he still had a majority there, Senator Levin. And I went to them the day before we were going to do the annual testimony. I always testified together with a Special Operations Command commander. And I said, if you ask me the question you've been asking the other combat commanders, I want you to know what the answer is you're going to get, because neither of you are going to like it. Senator Levin, you're not going to like it because I'm going to say you should let the review continue full course. Senator McCain, you're not going to like it because it is going to imply my sense that this is not that big a deal, but we should do the review. And I was going to look at, in a fairly rigorous fashion, what do we think the effect will be on recruiting, readiness, and retention, the three big tasks that a military performs. And I said, you know, perhaps instructive to look at our allies, the Israelis, perhaps our, I think the British by then, the Canadians. What about, by the way, the CIA and the FBI, our partners on the battlefield? What about, and you just keep going through. And I said, but, you know, let's let the review run its course. But it was sort of clear where I was heading. This was going to be a big deal because Senator McCain had said that he would listen, he wanted to hear what the generals had to say. He was quoted on that. In many respects, I was his general. I mean, he was about the only, one of the only three left in the Senate that supported the surge. It was the three amigos, we called them, McCain, Lieberman, and Graham. And I didn't want to, you know, do something that would blindside them. But I felt fairly strong in this. And up to that point in time, you'd had just the chairman of the Joint Chiefs that said it was just wrong. Now that's, I believe, was correct as well. But it didn't have the granular. You needed to have a little bit more intellectual underpinning to, you know, why and what and all the rest of this. And this is a 10-minute statement. It was, I'd written it for the previous month over and over. I'd even alerted Max Boot, conservative columnists, and others, some on the Fox News and so forth, said this is coming. And so the day comes, they ask the question, and I said, well, Chairman, Vice Chairman, as you know, I have a statement. I'm prepared to read it. They said, well, how long will it take? And I said, about 10 to 12 minutes. The chairman said, I'm not prepared to yield my time, Vice Chairman. Are you prepared to yield yours? And my heart was racing. I mean, look, I'd done these hearings. This was a big moment, and that was it. And so I gave it to the review panel and said, you know, put this in the files for history. But the bottom line was, I'm sorry to go on at length of that, but I just didn't think that was going to be a big deal, and it has not proven to be a big deal. With standards, again, you know, gay guys can't hit on other guys any more than guys can hit on women or vice versa, or, you know, if you see what I mean, that there are standards of behavior. They apply to everybody. And so that's the same thing that you have to have, obviously, with the expansion of more areas for women. But here it's about standards of performance, of physical performance. And if you can do it, if you're an artilleryman and you can heft a 155 millimeter shell, which is heavy, knock yourself out, but prove it. By the way, there are a lot of guys that will not meet these standards. And if you really nail them down and make them rigorous, you're going to find that perhaps some of those that are already serving might not make it, because we have this standard physical fitness test that, you know, you get age points on it and a bunch of other nonsensical things. I used to always compete against the 17 to 21 year old age crowd on that PT test. Because I said, you know, the enemy is not looking over his weapon at me saying, let me think, is he the 35 to 41 year old age group? In which case he gets two extra steps before I pull the trigger. Or, you know, some of this stuff was just sort of a little bit less than fully sensible. So I think it comes down to standards. I think if a woman can meet a standard, then I think in general, we're gonna have to open it up. We do need, however, having said that, to understand the dynamics that in small units and to see how that works out, frankly. And I think it can work, but we'll see.
And so do you think next year, for example, that at West Point, the juniors and the women, juniors and seniors, will be branching infantry? It's the equivalent of them declaring that as their major.
I don't, well, not a major. It's the branch you're going to go into. You still have an academic major, and, you know, it's a good old college. It is hard to say. I tend to think probably so in the Army. As again, to my knowledge, the Army has not filed for an exception, which gives me a sense of where that is headed. The bigger issue, again, is actually standards. We've been talking about this for quite some time. Standards are actually very, very hard to determine. And they're going to have to hold withstand the scrutiny of an awful lot of people that are going to want to chip at them and say, well, why does the rucksack have to be 80 pounds? Why, or maybe it should be 100 pounds, like in Afghanistan? Or, you know, again, we're going to have to work our way through this. And there's also going to have to be a component that is literally an endurance component, because the challenge for a number of women in Ranger School who are all elite athletes, I mean, they're extraordinary. They make it through the physical fitness test fine, the other events. It was the sheer pounding day after day after day to the musculoskeletal structure that they found difficult. And so there's even an issue there. But again, the three that made it, they made it through the whole way. The commander of the Ranger Training Brigade happens to be a former aide of mine who is a tremendous officer, Colonel David Fivecoat, and he and his instructors have absolutely hewed to their standards in this endeavor.
We'll have to wait and see how those women fare post-decision. I would like to open it up to questions. If you all have questions, I believe we have a mic going around.
Hi, General. Hi, General Petraeus. My name is Eitan. I'm a sophomore broadcast journalism student here. First of all, thank you to Director Bay and Vice Dean Seib for hosting moderating the debate. And thank you, General Petraeus, for being here. And thank you for your service to our nation.
Privilege.
And my question for you is actually, I'm just getting a CNN notification on my phone now that says, quote, U.S. intelligence suggests the crash of the Russian plane was likely caused by a bomb planted by ISIS or one of its affiliates, according to a U.S. official. So even though we don't have all the information yet about this airliner, what do you think brought it down? And do you think ISIS poses a direct threat to our nation here in America?
Yeah, first of all, I think it does pose a threat to our nation. I'm not sure if it's worth distinguishing between direct and indirect. It's a threat, and it has manifested itself in attacks in the United States that have been inspired by the Islamic State use of social media in a very skillful manner. That's very worrisome. I've talked to people, for example, the New York Police Department Intelligence Division, their counterterrorism, and they are very, very actively working to identify individuals that might be prone to such activity, doing it legally. But they're doing a lot more below the surface than people realize. And I think the same is true of the national organizations as well. And I'm just afraid that the day is going to come where people can go to a gun show, buy a bunch of weapons not that different from the weapons we give to soldiers on the battlefield, even bigger magazines than we carry on the battlefield, a lot of ammo, and go into a mall somewhere that's crowded on a weekend and just open fire. And maybe you do it at a couple of other malls as well. And you can imagine what that will do, again, to the feeling of security. We already have this to get on an aircraft. We don't have it to get in. We have it to get into a stadium. We have it in a lot of other places where there are lots of people. And I hope it's not going to be some so intrusive. And the security measure is so costly that it literally is a, I mean, this is literally a drag on the economy to some degree. I mean, what we have to do with TSA and all the rest. So that's very worrisome. And the Islamic State has shown a skill, a facility, a capability to do this in a way that no other organization has done as effectively or as substantially. I think, you know, what we have some confidence in with the airliner is that it was not hit from the outside. So the notion that ISIS shot down a plane flying at 31,000 feet with a shoulder-launched weapon, I mean, it's hard to see a plane flying at 31,000 feet, much less lock onto it, get the lock tone and everything else, and then you're at the very edge, you're probably beyond the range of most of the kinds of systems that might be available in the black market out there. So that leads you to believe it was something, again, that, and it did break up, so something, there was some explosion of some type. I think the question has been, you know, was it something planted by an extremist group, or was it something in the cargo bay? You know, we've had problems with various, you know, lithium batteries, let's say, or something along those lines. Now, this is quite more spectacular than would seem to be suggested by something like that. So if it's on CNN and it was leaked by an intelligence official, I'm sure it's first with the truth. Yeah.
Hi, General. Is that on? Hi, General. Thank you for being here. My name is David Merrill. I'm a master's student in the MS Journalism program here. You asserted that a Snowden-type leak could not happen at the CIA. What does the fact that a teenager was able to hack the CIA director's personal email account say about the CIA's security protocols?
Nothing. I mean, it's an America Online account. He's not doing any official CIA business. I mean, it's unfortunate that a public figure has his personal privacy attacked in that way, but I mean, he wasn't doing, I didn't see anything on there that had anything to do with what he has done either when he was in the White House or when he was the director of the CIA. There are unclassified systems that you work on in the CIA, but they are, it literally is a UCIA.gov ending to it. It's all publicly known. You do send unclassified traffic on that, but that's, again, just for the way you actually do your official business rather than, say, doing it on, again, his America Online account. And then, obviously, you have a very secure top secret and beyond system on which you operate for the rest. And beyond that, you have compartments into which only certain people can get. And this is very, very rigorous in its architecture, if you will, because it's publicly known the CIA, in fact, I was the director when we contracted our cloud services. We could not keep up. We tried to build our own cloud. I mean, a cloud, after all, is just lots of servers and switches. Cloud is massive amounts of them, and then has lots of scalable storage, and usually it also has software as a system that provides massive computational power. But we could not keep up with all of the data that we were accumulating. And a lot in today's day and age is about use of big data from every conceivable source, and then very powerful programs, apps, et cetera, that enable you to manipulate that and identify linkages, trends, stuff just pops out of the haystack, the needles all come together and you have it. And it's quite extraordinary in the day and age that we are here, approaching the Internet of Things, where there's so much digital dust out there, there's so many digital fingerprints, if you will, that we all leave. And by the way, it has really invalidated a lot of the traditional methods of tradecraft. You just can't do what you used to do if you're getting an iris scan as you go through the airport, or fingerprints as you go through the airport. You can't ditch that passport and pick up another one at a dead drop and check into the hotel, because when they check it at the hotel, it's wired into the customs service, and if you didn't come through customs, you've got a problem on your hands. So it's very, very difficult nowadays. Also very difficult to go in alias or clandestine, if you will, given that, you know, people have social media pages and there's so much information about them on them. So again, I I think it just says absolutely nothing about it. I will tell you that what is an issue of enormous attention is the system administrators who have oftentimes privileges that extend way beyond what an individual would be able to do, obviously, with just his own password and identity. And we went to, in some cases, dual key kinds of requirements for certain actions, and very, very careful scrutiny of those who are the system administrators. It used to be in the world of intelligence that the person you want to recruit as a spy is the cable, the person who does cables, because that, you know, you get the code to the cables anywhere in some Soviet mission in small country. It's good for all the other cables usually in the entire system. Nowadays, it's the system administrator, and businesses have to be very, very cognizant of that risk as well, because there's enormous business, not just criminal activity, but also other kinds of business activity that is, again, taking on so much more importance as we have so much more that's stored either in your own space or in a cloud.
Hi, General Petraeus. Thanks for coming. My name is Allie. I'm a broadcast journalism student. I'm here with ATVN, Annenberg TV News, and Annenberg Media. And I was wondering, has it been difficult coming back after dealing with personal issues last year?
What do you think? you know, look, at the end of the day, we go through lots of challenges in life. Some of them are a result of, you know, external things, and some of them you had a hand in, and that makes it even tougher. And I fortunately had a number of good friends, had supportive family and others, and frankly business partners and so on, and even candidly USC. And somebody at that point in time sent me a note, and he said, you know, there's a saying, don't tell me how high the guy jumped, tell me how high he jumped back after getting knocked down. And there's a lot to that.
Thank you, General.
Thank you. My name is Diane Zapanta Elder, and I'm an alumni of this school. Back when we had about six classrooms above the bookstore, the old bookstore. So
come a long way.
I've come. It's amazing I'm still standing. But anyway, we're very glad that you are back.
Well, that's kind of you. Thanks.
Yes. I have two questions for you. The first one is, did the CIA, or did they not, release intelligence after the Benghazi attacks in 2012 that the attack was due to a film? And question number two is, the Pentagon has recently released a report that there is a 50% increase in sexual assault in the military. How does that square with your comment about standards?
The latter one I'll take first. I mean, that is an issue of enormous concern, needless to say. I mean, you can't have predatory behavior, if you will, by individuals who, you know, have to be hugely concerned about the soldier on their left and right. At the end of the day in combat, if you're in a really serious firefight, you're not motivated by thoughts of the American flag, democracy, the Constitution, motherhood, apple pie, or how the, you know, LA Lakers did the night before. You're motivated by a fierce desire to not let down the person on your left and right, and the knowledge that they have the same fierce desire. And so the fabric of a unit, at a small unit level in particular, when you're in very tough situations, matters enormously. And so, again, that's why, again, none of this kind of activity, again, if it's predatory sexual activity or any other kinds of adverse, if you will, treatment of individuals, we've had hazing cases over the years, we've had other different cases, that is something that tears at the fabric of that small society, and that's why it can't be tolerated. There's a lot of work going on to determine why the increase. Is it and there are different explanations from it. One is, and I think this is a positive factor, that victims are coming forward much more than they did in the past. They feared in the past that if they came forward that they would actually be victimized rather than listened to. And there's, you know, there were cases of individuals who came forward and actually ended up, they were the loser rather than the individual who inflicted something untoward on them. It is publicly known on Benghazi that the initial assessment by the senior analyst in the agency, what's called the Mideast North Africa division, probably a two-star equivalent woman, very, very competent, extraordinary, that the assessment that she provided and that her team provided, and which we subsequently provided to Congress and to the administration, was that there was probably some linkage to the film, and also that there was also the issue about how spontaneous was this, was it planned or was it not? That's still actually a subject of some debate, and I think it should be. There's actually films of this, you know, security footage, and this is not a great, you know, Marine unit going in. This is a milling around crowd that's building and building. And I don't think it was, you know, a real error to extrapolate that on a day in which you had embassies all over that region under attack. Remember, the embassy in Cairo was completely overrun. Happily, it was one of the new embassies with all ballistic glass and locking doors. You just button up and ride it out. They can't get in. You look at them, they look at you, and eventually they get tired and leave, and you restore security. The embassy in Yemen was overrun. The embassy in Tunisia was severely damaged. There was a fear in Sudan. There were tens of thousands of marchers in Pakistan who were unable to get to the embassy, thankfully, thanks to the actions of the Pakistani police and security forces. Numerous demonstrations that turned violent in Afghanistan. And again, I could just keep walking you around that region. And you have that one that night, and I think it's not illogical that there might be some extrapolation that this had at least something to do with it. But whether it was a terrorist, or from the very beginning, we knew which organizations at least were involved, and this is all publicly known, that it was at least some of the members of Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Land of the Maghreb, and then one other organization, I think it was Ansar al-Sharia, that we knew that their members were involved in this. Some of this, for classification reasons, early on, when we still didn't want people to realize what kinds of sources and methods we had that could give us insights, some of that was taken out of that public statement that was issued. But it, you know, that wasn't for political reasons. That was taken out just because of a concern. In fact, one of it was taken out before it even got to me. Look, the people that made the call on this, and the moment they had, I think it was within 10 days, now that's long, but there's an awful lot of going back and looking at, trying to pull in what we called all sources of intelligence, contacting all of your human sources, reviewing all of your signals, cyber, anything you can gather, bring it together, and then they came back and said, that, you know, does not appear to have been linked, and we reported that forthrightly as well. But, you know, this has become such an emotional issue. It was an election year at that time, as you recall, just 2 months or less than 2 months prior to an election. And this has continued in a variety of different ways.
We're going to do one more question. And you.
Thank you for being here, General. I had a question in reference to, I'm a USC graduate student. I'm studying corporate communication. My name is Frank Rivetta, and I study from a distance program. Thank you all for hosting. The question is, in the book Insurgents, Mr. Kaplan identifies a new and unconventional type of soldier that began to be sought after. My question is specifically, in the workplace today, how would a CEO or a group of executives identify and train and kind of reap this type of unconventional type minded person to spark creativity and innovation in the workplace?
That's a wonderful question, actually. Thanks. So in the book, in The Insurgents, written by Fred Kaplan, really a great journalist and great writer, previously wrote his fantastic book, The Wizards of Armageddon, we were the insurgents, and I was the, you know, the head insurgent, if you will. It was really about how the insurgents within the military sought to change some of our military doctrine, to change the way we prepared forces to go to war. It's a year-long road to deployment, as we called it, to make them much more capable on a battlefield that was very different from that of, say, Operation Desert Storm, where it was just largely tanks on tanks. You know, it was all, there was no civilians on the battlefield for the most part. There weren't guerrillas, insurgents, host nation officials, suicide car bombers, all these complications on the modern day battlefield of irregular warfare, if you will. And what we were trying to do was, first of all, develop a doctrine that would give us the intellectual capital, then to impart that in the different schools and centers. And it was fortunate I was the three-star in charge of about 18 different schools and centers in the Army. We called it the Engine of Change. Changed the training, collective training that was done. So instead of out in the Fort Irwin, California desert, where, again, tank on tank, now you have villages, you have host nation forces, you have sheikhs, you have religious figures, you have insurgents, you have terrorists, you have car bombs, improvised explosive devices, and all the rest of that during the training, as well as, obviously, to train as realistically as we could. And what we were, and then into the leadership development of all of our commissioned, non-commissioned warrant officers, and on and on, and lessons learned teams and everything else, counterinsurgency academies. What we wanted to develop was what we called pentathlete leaders, and this is the leader you're talking about, and then units, that, in a sense, pentathlete units. So these were units that not only could attack and defend, these leaders could also sit down with a local sheikh and figure out how to assess the situation with him, how to enlist him, how to try to get them on board. These leaders could understood how to do, in a sense, local nation building, how to work with, again, the locals, how to address issues at local governance and all the way on up, and then at the level where I was, of, you know, in a sense, helping a country rebuild itself with quite considerable assets. You know, we had 160,000 U.S. troops alone in Iraq at the height of the surge, had at least that many contractors on top of that. So this is, and had quite considerable resources. So we actually actively set about trying to make sure that we did protect and preserve what we called the iconoclast, the out-of-the-box thinkers. And there, I think it's in that book. It, you know, it's publicly known that I was brought back from combat. I mean, we're still in the first year of the surge, and Secretary Gates calls up and says, we want you to come back and be the president of a promotion board. I said, boss, I've never sat on a promotion board in my life, and why in the world, heck would I do that when I'm fighting the main effort out here? He said, no, it's important. It's the Brigadier General Board, and I got it instantly because there were a handful of individuals, one that's publicly known, but a couple of others that we were disappointed had not been promoted, in one case for 2 years previously. And so I was sent back out of combat. General McChrystal, commanding the Joint Special Operations Command, our counterterrorism forces, he's back for it. I mean, you don't pull him out of combat. The Secretary of Defense's three-star military assistant is on the board. So I look around, and it's all, you know, our kind of fellow insurgents. I was not the senior four-star on the board. In fact, I was the junior four-star in the military at the time, I think. But I was made the president of the board. So this is interesting. That's how you do it. You intervene. You get in there. And you preserve and protect the iconoclast. We had a promotion list come to me one time at the agency. It was for the same equivalent, sort of the new one stars, the senior intelligence service. And there was no woman from the National Clandestine Service. I knew that women that were spectacular chiefs of station, which is the key billet typically before you're going to make SIS. I said, what's the deal? And they said, well, they fell outside. It's only a one-year zone. And so I said, this is the second or third year that we've had no women. What are we telling 40% of our workforce? that we can't find a female spy who could lead at the one-star level? And so I said, open up the zone another year. Now, in the agency, you're allowed to do that. We could not actually have done that in the military. It's much more legally binding. But that's what you do, and the same is what you do in business world. You've got to, we actually, KKR has an extraordinary diligence process to get into that firm. I mean, I had to do, I think, between 16 and 20 interviews. Stretched out for quite a period. But KKR has no jerks, at least not one I've found, and it's a team of all-stars. We actually worry sometimes that we don't have a jerk or two, because we need a couple of those just to disagree. You can't have a situation where everyone agrees, and the co-founders, brilliant businessmen, you know, multi-billionaires that are and true gentlemen and everything else. These guys actually create situations at the partners' meetings where we challenge the big ideas, and they set this up. And so you create some constructive intellectual discord, and that's what you got to do. You can't have a bunch of, you know, group-thinking people that don't have the guts to raise their hand and say, excuse me, I did this, by the way, in Kuwait as a two-star before we did the fight to Baghdad, the big final pep talk. And I say, excuse me, could you go over one more time what we do after we take down Baghdad? And they said, you don't worry about that, Dave. You get us to Baghdad. We'll take it from there. And obviously, that didn't quite work out that way. So this is a really important point that you have raised here, and a very important question. And firms, military organizations, schools, universities, everybody needs to preserve and protect some of the out-of-the-box thinkers who are a little bit the bomb chuckers, but are very, very useful, I think, for igniting constructive intellectual discourse.
General, let that be the last word, unless you have something that you'd like to add before we thank you and send you on your way.
Well, look, first of all, again, I appreciate both of you sharing the stage here. Appreciate all of you staying in this, again, energetic place. Look, what you're doing here in both preparing journalists and preparing those who will do so-called public diplomacy is hugely important. You know, we're in the middle of a campaign now, and there are times, I'm sure, where all of you look and you just want to, I mean, this, how can they say that? This is outrageous, and this is on all sides. And a democracy like ours functions best when you have informed citizens who are carrying out great discussions and debates that have some degree of nuance and detail. They are more than you're going to get on an Instagram post or a Twitter post. And you all will play a critical role, but at a time when there is incredible change and transition in this space. And so, you know, my hat's off to those in this school who run it, Dean and others, and also to those who are enrolled here. You are very, very fortunate indeed. This is a crown jewel of this particular area. Thanks very much.
General, thank you. Thanks, Bill.